is the Thriving Dentist Show with Gary Takacs, where we help you develop your ideal dental practice, one that provides personal, professional, and financial satisfaction.
Welcome to another episode of the Thriving Dentist Show. I'm Gary Takacs, your podcast co-host. We have a great episode for you today. It's titled Coach John Wooden as Your Mentor. I think you're really going to enjoy this episode, and you're going to learn how we can apply so much of his knowledge and wisdom and experience to you as a dentist to your practice, to develop your practice to full potential. So I think you're going to enjoy this one. Hey, before I get to that episode, though, a couple of announcements to make. First announcement is coming up on November 16th, 17th, and 18th. We have our next Thriving Dentist MBA workshop. It's a live stream workshop. 9 hours of content spread out over 3 evenings. So it's 3 hours an evening. It's from 7 to 10 p.m. Eastern time. And I cover in that Thriving Dentist MBA workshop the 10 elements of a thriving practice. Included, I talk about 6 goals that I want every dentist to embrace. We talk about systems, the 24 systems that will help you develop a thriving practice. And one of those systems is how to successfully reduce insurance dependence. We run it as a workshop, even though it's a live stream format, it's done on Zoom. We run it as a workshop, and we have 11 different exercises throughout the 3 evenings so that the exercises are designed to help you apply the information that you're learning in your practice. It's very affordable. You get 9 hours of CE. Come join us. You can go to thrivingdentist.com /MBA. It does sell out. All of our Thriving Dentist MBA workshops have sold out in the past. I would expect the same this time. And we do limit attendance because of the fact that we run it like a workshop. If there's seats available, come join us. We'd love to have you join us. Hey, the second announcement that I have is we have another top clinical tip to share with you in this episode. This is from my longtime friend, Dr. Nikki Green. Nikki Green practices in Fort Worth, Texas, and she's going to share a wonderful tip with you that will help you improve your clinical efficiency, something I think you'll all appreciate. Now, here's Nikki Green.
Hi, my name is Dr. Nikki Green. I practice on the west side of Fort Worth, Texas. I have a clinical tip today for the Thriving Dentist community. So this is a clinical tip that was actually given to me years ago when I was a younger dentist working on my efficiencies in dentistry, and I had a more experienced dental assistant who gave me the advice that if I would do my clinical dentistry in the same order every time, I would get a better result from my dental assistant. And man, was she wise in giving me that tip. So I want to go into a little bit of depth of what I mean by that. So if you're working on your own clinical efficiency, you're working on your relationship with your dental assistant, and your goal is to create an efficiency that your patients even remark about. So an example of that is I love it when at the end of a procedure, my patients remark with, man, you guys are a well-oiled machine, or man, you guys really work well together. Man, y'all don't hardly even communicate, but yet you seem to be exactly on the same page. That's the kind of clinical efficiency that I'm looking for. So, again, I have to give credit to a dental assistant, Ashley, who gave me this advice. But the piece of advice was make sure you're always doing your clinical steps in exactly the same order. So let me give you an example. Doing a filling, my clinical steps are obviously when I'm doing the filling, the clinical steps might include matrix bands, you know, your etch and bond steps. I'm not actually going into depth about those. It's more about what I do after I'm done filling. So after I'm done doing an occlusal or a class 2 composite, posterior composite, I always do things in this order. Remove all the matrices, carve my anatomy, remove the bulk of excess flash. Then I start checking occlusion. I keep checking occlusion until I've got occlusion exactly where I want it. Then I come back and do my fine polishing and removing of the fine excess flash. I always ask for a scaler so that I could scale in between the teeth, make sure I remove any flash of bonding agent, that type of thing. And then the very last thing I do is check floss. Even on a class one composite, I want to check floss to make sure I don't have any bonding agent in between the teeth that might prevent the patient from being able to floss when they get home. So I always do things in that order. Prior to being given that piece of advice, sometimes I might would check interproximal contacts, remove flash, then check occlusion. The next time I might check occlusion first. All of that just creates, you know, inconsistencies between you and your dental assistant and slows you down and makes each of your jobs harder. So just always do things in the same order. Comes to a crown seat, I always, you know, take off the temporary, clean off excess cement, address the tissue. If I've got bleeding tissue, I want to get that under control before I ever start putting the restoration in the mouth. Put the restoration in the mouth. I always check margins, check contacts, and only then do I check occlusion. And then even after all three of those steps, only then do I do a pre-cementation x-ray. So those are just a couple of very basic dentistry tips that have definitely contributed to my efficiency in my practice and definitely contributed to the relationship between me and my dental assistant and taking that relationship to one that even patients remark about. So, you know, consider it a simple one, but I think it's an important one. Clinical tip of just making sure you're always doing things in the same order each and every time to make things more predictable and better for working smarter, not harder, for you and your dental assistant. Hope this helps, and happy Monday to the thriving dentist community.
Welcome back to the Thriving Dentist Coaching in Action segment. This is Naren, your co-host. Today's topic is an awesome topic. I love mentors, and today Gary is going to be diving into what he got out of, you know, John Wooden, Coach John Wooden, and how what he learned from Coach Wooden can apply to a dental practice. You know, I have had mentors along the way. Some I have met in person. My dad, for example, was one of my first mentors. And then others, they were mentors that because I read their books, so I watched their thoughts in the form of videos and so forth, like Steve Jobs, for example. Even though I've never met him personally, but I've read like every book written about him and written by him, or, you know, every quote from him. So it's a great topic, Gary. But before we jump in, I want to take a moment to thank our expert today who gave us the clinical tip, Dr. Nikki Green. She shared a wonderful tip. If you haven't listened to it, just go back and listen to it. And we'll also put some information about how you could perhaps, you know, get in touch with her. So Gary, let's jump in to today's topic.
Yeah, you know, I'd be hard-pressed to pick a better mentor than Coach John Wooden, the late legendary coach of UCLA basketball. We lost Coach Wooden in 2010, 11 years ago, at the age of 99, Aaron. He passed away in June of 2010. Had he made it to October, he would have been 100 years old.
Wow.
I think we could count that a life well lived, couldn't we?
Absolutely. And that reminds me, there are several other legends in dentistry. They all lived long lives, right?
Yeah. There seems to be a kind of a commonality among you know, longevity and happiness and success.
Yes,
for sure. Well, you know, Coach Wooden doesn't need much credentialing, but, you know, I realize that the older I get, that there may be younger listeners that aren't as familiar with Coach Wooden. So let me just take a minute and credential him for just a minute. And I want to emphasize that what I'm about to share with you is a partial achievement list of Coach John Wooden. So here we go. He won 10 NCAA championships, college men's basketball NCAA championships, 10 of those. By the way, if a basketball coach wins one of those today, they would consider that an epic career, right, Aaron?
Yes, yes.
He won 10 of those. 10 of those, you know, imagine. He had 4 undefeated seasons as UCLA basketball coach, 30-0, 30 wins, no losses, 4 of those. He had an 88 game at one point in his tenure at UCLA as a coach. He had an 88 game winning streak, won 88 games in a row that spread over four seasons. Maren, can you name a men's NCAA basketball team that's had an undefeated season recently? Go ahead, take your time.
I can't think of any, Gary.
That's because there aren't any.
Right.
There aren't any. You know, he had 19 conference championships. And by the way, he was an All-American as both a player and a coach. That's just a partial list of some of his achievements. But one of the really interesting things, by the way, I have a personal connection to Coach Wooden. I had the privilege to meet him and actually had the privilege to work with him. And it's an experience that I absolutely treasure. One of my clients actually played basketball for Coach Wooden at UCLA. By the way, this dentist was 6'9". Can you imagine a dentist being 6'9"? He was 6'9", and he played basketball under Coach Wooden. Chose to be a dentist rather than follow a professional basketball career. And he introduced me to Coach Wooden. And I volunteered. Coach Wooden often did fundraising projects for PBS, for the public broadcasting system for public radio. And I participated as a volunteer in a couple of his fundraising projects. And by doing that, I got a chance to meet him and spend some time with him. It's time that I absolutely treasure. Well, one of the things that I want you to know about Coach Wooden is that when he graduated from high school, he grew up in a small town in Indiana. And when he graduated from high school, his father shared with him six concepts that he wrote down on a piece of paper. And that was his graduation gift to his son, John. And Coach Wooden said that these six concepts that his dad shared with him were worth more than any monetary gift his dad could have ever given him, because they served him for his entire life. Hmm. And they were really, they end up becoming his guiding light in how to live, how to live a productive, happy life. So I want to read each one of these to you. There's six concepts, six principles. His dad wrote them down. That was his gift, his high school graduation gift. Number one, we'll talk. I'll list these out, and then we'll talk about each one, and we'll talk about how it applies to dentistry. Number one, be true to yourself. Number two, make each day your masterpiece. Number three, help others. Number four, drink deeply from good books. Number five, make friendships a fine art. And number six, build a shelter against a rainy day. You know, those concepts are simple, Naren, but they're profound. Mm-hmm. They're profound because they can be applied in so many different ways. And we're going to take and talk about how we can apply those to our listeners in dentistry, to developing you to become a world-class dentist, and also to develop your practice to full potential. But before we get to that, I want to share one more detail about Coach Wooden. Do you know Coach Wooden never spoke to his basketball players about winning? Hmm. Never spoke to them about winning. Which sounds absurd, because wouldn't a coach want to talk about winning?
Yeah, team? Especially the coach who won the most number of championships ever.
But he never talked to them about winning. He simply talked to his players about doing their best in every game. And if they did their best, that was good enough for him.
Right.
But by the way, guess what happened when the team went out there and did their best? They did a whole lot of winning.
Yeah.
But he never talked about winning. He never talked about winning. He talked about simply his request, his desire was for you as a player to simply do your best in every game. And the byproduct of that was a whole lot of winning. It's kind of interesting.
Do you know why he did that? Like, do you know why, if you were to guess, or?
He was more interested in the process than the outcome.
Uh-huh.
In fact, all of his players, including my client, told me that the games were never won in the game. They were won in practice. They were, the games were won in practice by the discipline, by the habits, by the skill building that you did in practice. And I think of that in my training. You know, when I'm training for an Ironman, I think of it that my success in Ironman, it won't be the event. It'll be in the hundreds and hours that I did in my training. The event's just going to be a process to follow through. You know, all that.
The last step of the process.
The last step of the process. It's already a done deal, right?
Yeah.
And I like his thinking on that, because it's my client said his practices, man, you better be prepared in practice, because they weren't just going through the motions. That was the most important part of the process, was the practice. Well, let's go back to those six concepts. Number one, be true to yourself. Let's talk about how to apply that, you know, to you as a dentist. One of the ways that I see applying that is, the concept that L.D. Pankey taught, which is know yourself. Know yourself. Isn't that just another way to say know yourself, be true to yourself? And what I mean by know yourself is know what you like to do. Know what you like to do clinically. Do what you like to do. You know, and if you don't like doing something, don't pound a square peg in the round hole. Don't do something you don't enjoy. Be true to yourself. Be true to yourself. When I think about it in terms of practice development, it's to have a vision in your practice. You know, if you don't have a vision, your team can't help you get there. So have a vision, but be true to that vision and be accountable to your vision yourself. Because if you're not accountable to that, how can you ask your team members to be accountable for it? So hold yourself accountable to your vision. Are you doing the things that will manifest themselves in the form of your vision? And if not, what needs to change so that you can do that? But be true to yourself. You know, the happiest people I meet are absolutely true to yourself. They're true to themselves. They're genuine. They are who they are. And they work on improvement. Don't get me wrong. They work on improvement, but they remain very true to themselves. All right, let's go to the second point. Make each day your masterpiece. Aaron, there's a lot of profound thinking around that. Make each day your masterpiece. You know, so often we get fixated on, you know, the end result, like, you know, what we're going to do this year, what we're going to do this month. But really, this month is simply a string of days that we put together. Right. And if we make each day our masterpiece, then you're going to get to that finish line. So it's, you know, another way to say that is make the most out of every day. I'll get granular on that. One of the things you can do as a dentist is look for opportunities to help more people every day. Help more of your patients. Help more of your patients enjoy optimal oral health. Help more of your patients accept treatment that is, you know, treatment plan, but not scheduled yet. Look for opportunities to successfully add in treatment today. Make each day your masterpiece. How does that how does that concept relate to dentistry in your mind, Aaron?
I think every day there's an opportunity for a dentist and his team to, you know, make a difference in the lives of the people they touch. Could be clinically or could be emotionally. Like a lot of people look at their healthcare provider as that confidant, right? And many people go through all kinds of challenges. And usually when you have that relationship, usually, you know, I know my dentist, I've worked with my dentist for maybe 8 years now. So of course she's like outside of my own family, like somebody that I see on a regular basis, and she knows a lot about my health and even my family. So I think there's a huge opportunity, not just for the dentist, but for the entire team to be the shining light, so to speak, you know.
I agree. You know, and I think, you know, our listeners have heard me talk about legacy. I want all of our listeners to be in the process of creating a legacy, creating something that lives beyond you. And one of the ways you can do that is make sure that every day is your masterpiece. You make the most of it. Just a fun little tactical thing you can do at the end of your morning huddle, at the end of the morning huddle, after you've gone through the morning huddle process, ask your team members to look at the huddle, look at the schedule today, and answer this question. Whose life are we going to change today? Whose life are we going to change today? And if you did that every day throughout your career, I think it's safe to say that you're leaving a legacy. Think how many people's lives you've changed over those days. So make each day your masterpiece. Number three, help others. Help others. a two-word sentence that's absolutely profound. Help others. I think this really goes to why. Why do we do what we do? What's your purpose? What's your purpose? And I would suggest that a noble purpose is one that creates a lot of subscription around it. A noble purpose. And that is to truly change the people we interact with in a positive way, to change people's lives in a positive way. And certainly if we do that, can we agree we'll be helping others? And again, it could be clinically, it could be behaviorally, it could be emotionally. But lead with a noble purpose of helping others. That's a rallying point. That's a rallying point for your team members. It's a rallying point for your patients. And it truly does make your work worthwhile. So help others. Number four, drink deeply from good books. Now, I think we can contemporize that narrative, and I think we can bring in other mediums to that. They could be video, it could be audio, they could be books, they could be audiobooks. But lifelong learning, embrace lifelong learning is what that's right. Embrace lifelong learning. It's an absolute pathway to become as good as you can possibly be. Embrace the concept of being better tomorrow than you are today. And model it for your team so they want to follow your lead. So drink deeply from good books, another great concept. Number five, and we're gonna park on this for a little bit. Make friendship a fine art.
Hmm.
Doctors, I would like you to absolutely wrap your arms around this and really think about how that concept can help you fully develop a relationship-driven practice where your patients are your friends. You know, what is a thriving practice? It's a practice that provides personal, professional, and financial satisfaction. One of the best ways to achieve personal satisfaction is truly develop a relationship-driven practice because you're taking care of people you genuinely care about. And in then, your work has purpose and meaning and direction. Make friendship a fine art. And you know, this can be a challenge as your practice grows. But one of the ways to think about this, you know, I had a doctor recently ask me the other day, he goes, I have a big practice. You know, I've got 2,500 active patients. I can't remember all 2,500 of them. And I instantly responded to him, said, you don't have to remember 2,500. You just have to remember the ones you're seeing today.
Right.
And he looked at me and he was going to respond. And then he took a big sigh and he said, you're right. You're right. And all of a sudden it took it from like a seemingly impossible feat.
Right.
Or at least he was telling himself that to, hey, I can do this. I can do this one day at a time. I can do it. You bet I can do it. Make friendship a fine art. You know, if that's all you get away from the takeaway from this podcast episode, maybe that's something you write down. Maybe that's something you put on your desk. Maybe that's something you look at every day and you decide to take action on it every day. How am I going to exemplify the concept of making friendship a fine art? What can I do today?
Yeah, this is an important point because I think research suggests, I don't know if you're familiar with the blue zones. I'm sure you know what I'm talking about. And this particular person studied people who lived for more than 100 plus years. Every single one had strong friendships that lasted for decades.
It is interesting because we made the comment that we've identified some mentors that have lived a very long time.
Yeah, I mean, Dr. Pankey,
Dr. Dawson, Dr. Degoni.
Right.
And now Coach Wooden. And these people had rich friendships and vast variety in their friends, mm-hmm. you know, from various walks of life. But they truly were connected to so many people in a positive way. So make friendship a fine art. Maybe that's a recipe for a long life.
Mm-hmm.
Certainly a recipe for a happy life, you know,
for sure. Right.
And finally, number six, build a shelter against a rainy day. Build the shelter against a rainy day. Now, I'm going to get very specific on this one. One of our goals with our clients is to help our clients achieve financial independence so they can go to work because they want to, not because they have to. Go to work because you want to, not because you have to. And that simply means that you have enough resources that can reproduce your income for the rest of your life without having to go to work. Now, a simple concept, difficult in execution, but simple. Doctors, if you don't already do this, I want to encourage you to look into some type of a pension type savings plan. You know, it could be a 401k plan. It could be a money purchase pension plan. It could be just a personal savings that you put together. But I want you to get to the point where you can go to work because you want to, not because you have to. To me, that's what it means about building a shelter against a rainy day, for sure. Now, I have over 30 books, Maren, in my library. In fact, I can look at them right now. I have over 30 books that are either written by Coach Wooden or are about Coach Wooden. And one of them included this very cool segment about Woodenisms, things Coach Wooden said that made an impact on this author, Woodenism. And I chose to pick three Woodenisms to add to this podcast episode. And I want to go ahead and read those, and we'll do the same thing with these Woodenisms. We'll come back and talk about how this applies to dentistry. So here they are, three Woodenisms. Number one, do not mistake activity for achievement. Think about that for a minute. Do not mistake activity for achievement. We'll come back to that one. Number two, you may make mistakes, but you are not a failure until you start blaming others. And number three, it's what you learn after you know it all that counts. Wow. Those Woodenisms are pretty cool. Let's go back to the first one. Do not mistake activity for achievement. We've all been guilty of that. I'll be the first to raise my hand. Activity is great, but focused activity, intentional activity, direction behind your activity is what's really needed. Don't mistake activity for achievement. How does that apply? How can that apply in dentistry? How can that apply in your practice development? Just because you had a team meeting doesn't mean you got anything done.
All right.
Talk about practice development. It's not a team meeting until you finish it with two questions. Who's going to be responsible for this? Let's say you decided to do something. Who's going to be responsible for this? And then I win. Now, all of a sudden, the team meeting got converted to some accountability and results. So don't mistake activity for achievement. Common occurrence. Number two, you may make mistakes, but you're not a failure until you start blaming others. Doctor, if something happens in your practice, whose fault is it?
Finally, it's yours, because the buck stops with you.
The buck stops here. It's you. That can be a tough pill to swallow.
Because yes, I mean, the doctors who keeps pointing the finger at somebody else, they never solve the problems. It's just, they go around in circles.
Yeah. It's not a mistake if you learn something. It's not a mistake if you learn something. And you can't learn something if you're blaming someone else. The blame game. You know, I made it my life's work to study world-class dentists. World-class dentists don't blame others.
Right.
And regardless if there's merit to it and genuine accuracy around it. Nope. They'll take responsibility and accountability. And if you want to create, how many times have I heard a dentist say, I want to create accountability in my practice? Well, accountability starts with you. Starts with you for sure.
If you want everybody to show up for the morning huddle, you better show up for the morning huddle.
That'd be the first one there.
Right.
It's what you learn after you know it all that counts. I love that one. And that one has so much application in dentistry. It's what you learn after you know it all. And again, it goes back to that concept of lifelong learning. Dentistry, you know, the half-life of dental learning. Gordon Christensen said recently, the half-life of dental learning today is now 3 years. You know what that means, Darren, in just the definition of half-life? That means that we're going to know twice as much as we know right now 3 years from now.
Right.
Talk about the merry-go-round spinning at a fast rate. It's spinning at a fast rate. Keeping up with materials, keeping up with equipment, keeping up with techniques, keeping up with all of the related science and all of the burgeoning and growing science. This is really all about, you know, it's what you learn after you know it all that counts. I have a longtime client whose three sons have become a dentist and following in their dad's footsteps. And He told each one when they graduated from dental school that the license that you just earned, you know, when they passed their license and they became a practicing dentist, the license is a license to learn. Because now you're going to really learn. Yes, you got some fundamentals there at dental school, and congratulations for passing the boards, but your learning now begins. Now, I wonder how many dental students think, I'm done taking classes. No. You're not done taking classes. You're just beginning to take classes. You've got a great foundation, but embrace the concept of if it's what you learn after you know it all that counts. Because I'm telling you, you know, to bring it back to what we would like the purpose of this to be, to help you become a world-class dentist, develop your skills, and secondly, to create a practice that achieves its full potential. So let's go back and recap these real quickly. The six principles that his dad shared with him upon graduation, high school graduation: be true to yourself, number one. Number two, make each day your masterpiece. Number three, help others. Number four, drink deeply from good books. Number five, make friendship a fine art. Number six, build a shelter against a rainy day. And then three woodenisms that I'd encourage you to wrap your arms around. Do not mistake activity for achievement. You may make mistakes, but you're not a failure until you start blaming others. And number three, it's what you learn after you know it all that counts. Hope you've enjoyed this. We've got some great questions coming up. We'll hit pause here and come back and join us for the Thriving Dentist question and answer segment.
Welcome back to the Thriving Dentist Q&A segment. Gary, I have four questions for you. The first one is, Coach Wooden talks about drinking deeply from good books. What are your top five all-time favorite books?
Oh, I love that question. Thanks for asking. I have a list of my top five.
I'm sure you have more than five.
I have more than five, but I'm going to answer it in the context of the question. By the way, these are required reading for our clients, and we even do book club around these because there's so many profound concepts in these books. But I'm going to give you five that are must reads, must listen to, must e-read for sure. And I'm going to number them one through five, but they aren't numbered in importance at all. I could argue that they're equally important. Number one, A Philosophy of the Practice of Dentistry, written by Dr. L.D. Pankey. A Philosophy of the Practice of Dentistry. Now, that book has been out of print. However, the Pankey Institute is in the process of reprinting that book and reprinting it with a new foreword and some new information that really kind of contemporizes it, you know, into 2021 and beyond. So that book will soon be available again through the Pankey Institute. Just check with their site now and again. It depends when you're listening to this podcast, but it may be out by now. Be sure to check with that the Pankey Institute to order that book. We'll put a link in the show notes to order that book from the Pankey Institute. Now, I have read that book every year since it came out in 1984. Every year, at least once a year, I've read that book, A Philosophy of the Practice of Dentistry. And it's marked up there, and it has highlights and notes on every page. There's dog-eared corners. But I read it every year because every year I get new information based on the place I'm at the time that I read it again. So a really, really profound book that will establish a foundation that will serve you throughout your entire career. A Philosophy of the Practice of Dentistry by Dr. L.D. Pankey. Number two, my favorite business book of all time, the book Good to Great by Jim Collins. Good to Great by Jim Collins. If you're more of a listener, he actually narrates the audiobook version of that book himself. I always like it when the author narrates their own book, because when they do that, they emphasize the points that are very important. That book, Paul and I read in our first year of practice ownership. We read that together as book club. And that book served as literally a blueprint for our first year in practice, the book Good to Great. I'd like to think that all of our listeners, the book really applies to them, because I hope all of you are on the journey of taking a good practice and making it great. So Good to Great, number two. Number three, a classic that, again, is a must read, The 7 Habits of Highly Effective People by Stephen Covey. Seven habits. Those habits will absolutely serve you throughout your entire career. Great book. Great, timeless. Great book. Number four, How to Win Friends and Influence People, written by Dale Carnegie. If you're as interested as I am in developing a relationship-driven practice, there is no better textbook to follow than How to Win Friends and Influence People by Dale Carnegie. We read that together with our team as we were assembling our team for LifeSmiles. And to this day, many years later, my team members will make references from that book, How to Win Friends and Influence. And they tell me, you know, the really cool thing is, Gary, I can use this in my life. Imagine that, Naren.
Right.
Not just in practice, but in life. How to Win Friends and Influence People. It really is your fast track to a relationship-driven practice by following the concepts in that book. And finally, number five is a biography. It's a biography that you'll all love because it's about a person you love. It's a biography written by Dr. Peter Dawson. And it's titled A Better Way. And it's subtitled The Surprising Path to a Complete Life. If any of you need inspiration, Peter Dawson provides it in spades in that book, A Better Way, The Surprising Path to a Complete Life. A biography about Dr. Peter Dawson. So there you go. There's my top five, although there's many others, but we'll limit it to those for right now. And certainly if you read those five books, you would be drinking from some very good books. You'd be following the wisdom of Coach John Wooden's father, for sure. You'd be drinking from good books.
Thank you, Gary. We're going to put links to all those five books. Now, let me ask you the second question. I'm intrigued by the concept of making each day your masterpiece. Can this apply to dentistry?
Absolutely applies to dentistry. In fact, I'd like it not only to apply, but that to be a goal. Make each day your masterpiece. And that can be, you know, that can apply in many different ways. Make the most of every day. Look for opportunities to help others during your day by adding in treatment, by saving people a trip back to, you know, another trip to your office. You can take care of it for them today. Maybe it's a day business-wise. Maybe you're short of goal today, but instead of just giving it up, you figure out, how can I make things happen today so we achieve our goal? It's okay to talk about goals, you know, in this concept. So it's really about making each day your masterpiece. And it's about helping your team members take advantage of every opportunity we have today so we don't let any of that slip under the bridge. So really, it does apply to dentistry in many, many, many ways. And even if you just start very in a granular way, start talking about what opportunities do we have to add in treatment based on the patients we're seeing today to better serve them, to better serve them. That would be a good exercise to do in any morning huddle. And when you start seeing it through that lens, it becomes a habit that just repeats and repeats and repeats and repeats itself. And you put together a string of really good days. So absolutely can be applied to dentistry for sure.
Thank you. The third question is, I love the idea of helping others. I believe this is my driving purpose. Your thoughts?
Yeah. You know, the listeners have heard me say many times that dentistry rocks. Why does dentistry rock? Because we have the ability to change people's lives every day. And that really becomes a noble purpose that not only is feels good to you, but it's a rallying point for your team members, And you know, if you ask dentists and team members, what is the number one reason you chose to be a dentist or you chose to be a dental team member? You know the answer to this, Naren. What do people say?
I want to help others. I want to make a difference in their, I mean, usually it's like a childhood experience where they saw someone who they looked up to, who, you know, and they're like, I want to be like that person, helping other people.
Want to help others. Now, Naren, I'll put you on the spot. We haven't talked about this, so if you don't get it right, we'll have to edit it out. But I think you'll get it right. Of the different generations, and you know, we talk about generations in the population, of the different generations, what's the largest generational group today when we, you know, we have labels for different generations like baby boomers? What's the largest generational group today by numbers? It just happened in the last year. This group became the largest group.
Millennials.
Mm. Now, millennials, they're diverse, just like any generation is. You know, all baby boomers aren't the same. You know, all Gen Xers aren't the same. All millennials aren't the same. They have multiple facets. But among millennials, One of the common denominators among millennials is they want to be involved in something bigger than themselves.
Yes.
And if you create that opportunity in your practice for them to be involved in something to help others, then imagine how that can help your goal to attract and keep the best team. For example, I have a client, longtime client of mine. Jim's been a client of mine since 1990. Aaron, if I'm doing the math right, that's 31 years.
Right.
One of the things he does for his team, because his team are they're helpers. They want to help people. He funds a Habitat for Humanity trip every year for them. And the team goes to somewhere in the country and they participate as volunteers in a Habitat for Humanity project. He pays for everything. The practice pays for this. And, Aaron, the team members are compensated their normal salary while they're doing this.
Hmm.
They've gone all over the United States to do this. It doesn't have anything to do with dentistry. It has to do with building homes for others. But what a cool way to reward the spirit of these team members who are helpers. Is it any coincidence, Aaron, that Jim has long-standing team members? He's attracted and kept long-standing team members? Is that any coincidence?
No.
Their career is providing them opportunities they wouldn't have access to otherwise. So help others. And, we can look outside. Maybe we do get involved in dentistry. Maybe we choose to help others by doing volunteer dentistry. You can do charitable dentistry locally, regionally, nationally, internationally. Help people that maybe wouldn't receive dental care otherwise. And set up a way to do that in your practice. What a cool way to embrace Coach Wooden's father's concept about that two-word sentence. Help others. Push the envelope on that one a little bit.
And Coach Wooden definitely helped others, right? For sure.
Oh my goodness. Look at my opportunity to meet him. It was involved through a charity project with PBS, Public Broadcasting System, where he wanted to help those at PBS be able to spread their message even further. He was always helping others. Always. I mean, it was something that was just a signature element of his life.
Right. Last question. I like Coach Wooden's concept of it is what you learn after you know it all that counts. It seems to apply to Dr. Pankey's mastery ladder. Can you talk more about this?
Well, it sure does. What a great connection that our questioner had. Absolutely. It's what you learn after you know it all that counts. And the Dr. Pankey mastery ladder. Just to recap, the mastery ladder is something Dr. Pankey observed. And this is, observing quite literally thousands of dentists. And what Dr. Pankey observed was that at the very top of achievement was a group of dentists that truly achieved mastery status, that were master dentists in any way, shape, or form or definition that you would use. Truly masters at the art and science of dentistry. And his observation was that only 2% of dentists in the world would ever achieve mastery status. Right below that, in the rung on the ladder, if you think about it as a ladder, and the very top is mastery, right below that, the next rung below it, was he called them highly adept. Highly adept. These were dentists that were just, but that sounds very, very, very skilled. Any of us would be thrilled to sit in the chair of a dentist as a patient of a dentist that was highly adept. Very, very, very skilled. Now, not quite at mastery, but perhaps well on their way to achieving mastery. Does that make sense, Darren?
Yes.
And that group was 8% of dentists. So we got 2% at mastery, 8% at highly adept. Right below that, we had a group of dentists, 36%, a larger group, who he called students. Now, he didn't mean students in the sense of dental students. He meant students in the sense of dentists who were on their journey to become first highly adept and then later mastery. So they were, dentists on the journey. And they could be, any point in their career, but they were on their journey, they're students. They're genuinely interested in improvement and betterment, eventually to become highly adept, and perhaps eventually to become masters. And then there was a group on the bottom, 54%, the largest group of all, that were indifferent. Aaron, sadly, that group didn't care. Didn't care. And it was 54%. 54%. So I think the concept of it's what you learn after you know it all that counts is really what leads you to climb that ladder. I don't think that any of our listeners would fit in that bottom category where they're indifferent. Otherwise, they wouldn't be listening to this podcast. Right?
Right.
Yeah, they're not listening. Right. They're sitting around complaining about it. But our listeners are either students, highly adept, or masters. And it's really about the idea of what you learn after you know it all that counts, that will lead you to climb that ladder. And it's something that always gives you something to look forward to. You know, I was talking earlier today, Aaron, I was talking to a senior dentist client of mine. He's in his mid-60s. Now, he's healthy. He's well. He's healthy in mind, body, and spirit. He's really enjoying his practice. And I asked him, I said, hey, it's time to update your three-year CE plan. One of the things I teach my clients is to always have a ongoing three-year CE plan where they're going to take their big CE. And I always like to have that because that's always a carrot out there. It's always motivation to improve. And he said, you know, Gary, I'm so glad you brought that up because I've got some places I want to go, people I want to study under, things I want to do. I will send you an email later this week with my three-year CE plan. Thanks for triggering me to revisit this. This is a doctor 65 years old. You always want to have something to look forward to. So there is that concept of it's what you learn after you know it all that counts. There's always something more to learn. Always something more to learn. You know, Peter Drucker, Darren, you recognize his name as considered to be the father of business management, of the science of business management. By the way, here we go again. Peter Drucker lived to 98 years old. 98. There's another one, Darren, 98 years old. In fact, he taught full time at Claremont University in Los Angeles up to 98 years old. Very interesting. One of the things he did from age 80 on is he would choose a subject, maybe a subject he didn't have any familiarity with, he didn't have any knowledge of, and he would take a deep dive into that subject, and he'd spend 3 years studying and learning as much as he could about this. So it might be Japanese bonsai gardening. You know, it might be gourmet cooking, things that have nothing to do with business management. And he would follow those through. You know, for a three-year study. And what it did is it kept his mind crisp. It kept his mind active. And it kept him curious. Curiosity, Darren, is one of those qualities, one of those traits that I think we could all use more of. Your curiosity. Well, hey, guys, I hope you've enjoyed this episode about Coach John Wooden as your mentor. If you knew about John Wooden, hopefully you know more about him now. If I'm introducing you to John Wooden, I'm glad I've introduced you to John Wooden. Couldn't have a finer mentor in so many different ways. A lot of it is common sense, but as Dave Ramsey likes to say, the problem with common sense is it's not so common. maybe there's some great wisdom in here that you could pull some information out and apply it to your life. Well, as we come full circle here, I want to close with an announcement. At the beginning of the episode, I talked about our upcoming Thriving Dentist MBA workshop. But now, as I close, I want to talk about an event we have coming up called the RIDA, R-I-D-A, Reducing Insurance Dependence Academy, Virtual Summit. It's happening on Friday, November 12th. It's from noon to 6 p.m., 6 hours. 6 hours of content all about helping you successfully reduce your insurance dependence. RIDA is both a play on words. We want to help you get RIDA insurance. I know that's not grammatically correct, but I do like the way it sounds. And it's also an acronym, RIDA, R-I-D-A, Reducing Insurance Dependence Academy. By the way, we're gifting your tuition to the summit. It's virtual. Come join us. You don't have to travel. You can take that entire summit from the comfort of your home. You'll get 6 hours of CE. Come join us. You can register at www.rid.academy/summit. It is free, but you do need to register. So register and come join us. You'll be very impressed with our panel of guest speakers, guest contributors, panelists, lots of information that you can apply in your practice to help you successfully reduce insurance dependence. On that note, let me simply say thank you for the privilege of your time and tell you we will look forward to connecting with you on the next Thriving Dentist Show.
When you cry, be sure to dry your eyes, 'cause better days are sure to come. And when you smile, be sure to smile wide, and don't let them know that they have won. And when you walk, walk with pride. Don't show the hurt inside, because the pain will soon be gone. When you dream, dream big, as big as the ocean blue. When you dream, it might come true. When you dream, dream big.